In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. Welcome to the Whole Tech channel. Today our topic is LED, light emitting diode, one of the most common ways to generate light nowadays is to use a light emitting diode or LED. Like the other diodes, one of its characteristic is that it only allows the passage of electric current in one direction. But we didn't discuss why they emit light. So in this video, we will see how an LED works. LED lights have several advantages that make them one of the most popular lighting options, such as having low energy consumption, greater impact resistance, and longer lifespan. And as a result, they are available in many different formats. But instead of going directly to analyze an LED, we will start by reviewing how a common diode works, because in theory, these can also emit lights. It's just that they do it in an inefficient way. If we have a circuit with a lamp and a power source, energy will pass freely. The current can either flow freely or be stopped due to the composition of the diode. There is a semiconductor material called silicon, and there are two types of this material. If we examine the atomic structure of pure silicon, we can see that each atom has four valence electrons that are shared with the other four silicon atoms around it, forming a crystalline structure with covalent bonds, that is, they share electrons, resulting in total of 8 valence electrons per atom. Noble gases are the most stable elements known to man. Don't worry if you don't like chemistry. The important thing to remember is that 80 electrons per atom is the magical number that keeps everything tightly connected. In fact, they are interconnected, that when a new electron wishes to pass through silicon, the electrons that comprise it cannot move, trying to block the flow of current. This can be changed, however, by adding impurities to silicon in order to control its conductivity and convert it into an N-type or P-type semiconductor. If we introduce impurities with 5 valence electrons instead of 4, then we will have atoms with 9 electrons, because 8 was our magic number. We could say that one of the electrons will be left over or freer than others, allowing it to move and act as a conductor when connected to a power source. This alloy is known as an N-type semiconductor because it contains excess electrons which have a negative charge. However, if we do the doping with impurities that have 3 valence electrons, we will end up with atoms that have a total of 7 electrons. This means that we would have a gap that allowed electron to pass through while also causing the gaps to move in the opposite direction. Because this alloy contains one fewer electron than its stable form, it would have a positive charge and be referred to as a P-type semiconductor. Furthermore, to simplify the representation, each hole corresponds to a positive charge. When a P-N junction is found, depending on the polarization of voltage source, there are two possible outcomes. When the positive pole is connected to the N-type semiconductor and the negative pole is connected to the P-type semiconductor, the holes and free electrons move away, preventing the generation of an electric current. This is referred to as reverse polarization. If the polarity of the voltage source is reversed, the free electrons of N-type semiconductor can jump through the P-type semiconductor and close the circuit, allowing current to flow. This is known as direct polarization, and it is exactly in this case that the physical phenomenon that causes light emission occurs. Return to our atomic structure representation and zero on the point at which the two semiconductors make contact. We will discover that electrons are being transferred from an atom with a higher valence electron count to an atom with a reduced valence electron count. This is critical because the difference in the number of valence electrons is also related to the amount of energy that they have. In other words, an electron in a 5 valence electron atom has more energy than an electron in a 3 valence electron atom. This means that every time an electron crosses this junction, energy is lost, but energy cannot be created or destroyed. According to the law of conservation of energy, it can only be transformed, and in this case, the energy that electron lost when jumping from one atom to another became light, or more particularly photons. The fact that this occurs at the atomic level has another implication, because electrons always move from atom A to atom B. The amount of energy transformed in each jump will be constant. In practice, this means that the emitted light will always have the same wavelength frequency band. This also indicates that changing atoms A and B changes the impurities within semiconductors. We can emit lights with different spectra, specifically the visible spectrum. At this point, we can emit a variety of light colors. We already know how light is emitted. Let's look at a LED from the inside out. The first thing we'll need is a substance to which we will connect the rest of the material. We add an N-type semiconductor layer followed by thinner P-type semiconductor layer. The order is important because energy transformation occurs when we reach the last layer. Then we connect some cables so that an electric current can flow between the semiconductors and the light is emitted, despite the fact that it is extremely thin. So it doesn't cover it technically. Only with this we already have a functional LED. But to be more efficient, we will add a small reflector to direct the light, which will be integrated in one of the electrodes. And before covering everything in a transparent epoxy coating to make the set more resistant, we will add one last element, a layer of phosphorus, although this is only used in some cases, such as white light. In this particular case, the diode is actually emitting a bluish light, which when it comes into contact with the phosphorus layer causes it to emit a more yellow light. The combination of these two spectra is what creates the perception of seeing white light. Finally, I would like to discuss RGB diodes, which can produce multiple colors. Although there isn't much mystery left to it, the RGB name refers to the colors that comprise it: red, green, and blue. In this type of LEDs, three pairs of semiconductors are used to produce each color, and the voltage that passes through each of them is independently varied. The perception of various colors is created. That's it for now, and I'll see you in the next video.